For our next talk, we're going to be hearing from Kevin Schneider, who has been a lawyer for an elephant for the last 4 years. Speaking of elephants, kind of interesting, kind of cool. The topic of this talk is the elephant in the courtroom. We're asking ourselves the question of, will cell ag actually be better for animals? New York's highest state court will soon decide if an elephant is entitled to a writ of habeas corpus, the first American high court to consider if a non-human animal can possess that kind of legal right. I'm excited to get into this one. Please welcome Kevin to the stage.
Thank you.
Okay, all right, this is on. So it's great to be here, and I'm so glad we're all able to get together and support New Harvest, right? Tell everybody. So my talk's a little different, as you might have guessed, than what you've been hearing for the last couple days. And I've actually never really tried to jam my interest in cellular agriculture together with the work that I've been doing for the last 10 plus years, which has been focused on expanding rights for animals. So let's get right into it, because I got a bunch of stuff here. So. Oh, is it possible to put the presenter view on the thing? No, okay, wow, all right. So I gotta remember all this stuff I wrote. Okay, so there's a guy, a Harvard professor, who is currently, some of you may have heard of this, talking about reviving the woolly mammoth, bringing the woolly mammoth back from extinction. Now, if he manages to do this, right, which is a perhaps, maybe it won't happen, he might be surprised to find in, even in the 2020s, some people, maybe a lot of people, really eager to hunt those woolly mammoths or stick them in a zoo. Because the woolly mammoth is, cognitively speaking, very similar to the existing species of elephants. But of course, elephants, as you can see here in a representative example, can be used for all sorts of things, kept captive, can be kept in tiny zoos. And this is despite the fact that their cognitive complexity is, as Matt kind of touched on a little bit, we're only now learning just how much elephants have going on inside their brains. They, just a couple of examples, like the last speaker was touching on, there have been documented in the wild to meet groups, herds of elephants. So you're talking 15, 20 sometimes elephants. And they'll actually have discussions. They will be discussing where should we go. We're at a fork in the road. And these are life and death decisions, right? If you decide to go this way, turns out there's no water, maybe the whole herd dies. You go this way, you successfully get there. And so, not to mention the fact elephants have also been observed coming back to the same spots year after year, picking up the bones of their dead relatives and having moisture stream down their face. Now, you might have some people, behaviorists, say, well, we can't say that's crying. That's anthropomorphism. I'll leave you to judge whether, you know, whether or not that's the case. But the fact of the matter is, you know, this same professor, he could bring Neanderthals back to life. They wouldn't have any legal rights either. That's because in our legal system, only human beings are capable of having rights. Every single animal species, any other species whatsoever, is simply not capable of having rights. Of course, corporations, they have plenty of rights, but that's a whole different talk. I don't have time to get into all that, but I'm happy to chat about it. It's one of my other hobby horses. So, Frankenstein, I have a feeling that our professor friend has not really considered all of the implications, the philosophical issues of bringing a species or an individual back from the dead, you know, as it would be the case with the woolly mammoth. But, you know, philosophical issues, moral issues, they matter. They matter a lot, right? Anyone who's tried to do an experiment knows you got to get through the ethics people. That can be, I'm sure, kind of annoying. But these issues matter. They matter a lot. And so that's why you got people like me who are in court trying to remind the powers that be that they do. So this is Happy. Happy has been at the Bronx Zoo for the last 45 years. She's been alone in this little one-acre exhibit for the last 14 years. And she was taken from Thailand as a baby, a very typical story for elephants. She was brought to the US and has found herself in this, trapped in this zoo. But Happy also recently became the first elephant, the first non-human animal, to have a hearing at New York's highest state court. They actually heard arguments last month, and they're going to decide this month. So we're all kind of anxiously waiting to see what they'll say. And what we're doing is asking the court to recognize Happy as a legal person for purposes of the right to bodily liberty protected by common law habeas corpus and order her free to a sanctuary. All right, that's a lot. So to go into some of the legal terminology, we talk about the common law. That's just a way of saying that the law that judges make in a case-to-case, on a case-to-case basis, as opposed to, say, applying statutes or constitution. And habeas corpus is an old common law legal remedy. So if you find yourself detained and you think there's no reason I should be locked up in this box, you or somebody else on your behalf can petition a court for a writ of habeas corpus, which requires, if they say, hey, this person shouldn't be locked up, then the court orders them to be released. And when we talk kind of the most important thing here, I think, for our purposes, this idea of what is a legal person. A legal person, you know, you hear person, you think you or me, human being, but in the law it has a whole different meaning. And it basically just means any entity with a capacity for rights or duties. That being said, when we've actually brought this question or similar questions to courts, they've said animals, not persons, can't be persons, get out of here. But we've kept going, and over the years, this issue has really, I think, kind of hit the mainstream in a big way, whereas kind of with cellular meat, you know, 10, 12 years ago, you talk to people about this, they just think you're completely crazy. Some people might still think we're crazy, but that's okay, because, you know, you have folks like Jill Lepore in The Atlantic calling Happy's case the most important animal rights case of the 21st century, and you have judges who are really surprisingly coming closer and closer to actually saying for the first time, yeah, rights in our system do not need to be limited to the human species. So I'm speaking to a crowd, of course, that understands these kind of technical challenges, obscure challenges, and how they can really have huge consequences. So this is the Amazon rainforest, and it's sadly looking pretty beat up. But consider that Amazon Inc. is a thriving legal person with all kinds of rights, while the Amazon rainforest, which is infinitely more valuable, is a legal thing. It's property, it can be divided up, it can be destroyed to make way for cattle ranching and soy cropping. And that's a huge problem, right? So I had to do a little, editing here. So yeah, everyone in the room, I think, can be forgiven for thinking that the law basically sucks. I'm hoping I can redeem it a little bit, but the food system, I think, is in an equally, for all kinds of different reasons, bad place. And fortunately, all the other folks here have been kind of handling that, but I'm hoping to maybe give a little bit of confidence in the law. And I think one thing that comes across in the law a lot, sometimes they don't like it or they don't think they're doing it, but is the idea of philosophy. So that, for me, is kind of the elephant in the room. And we've seen it again and again. We go to courts, we ask, we began with chimpanzees, can a chimpanzee have a right not to be in a cage and go to a sanctuary? We got close with those cases in a way in New York, but ultimately they said, no, not a human. So the reason I put this up here is an amazing book by a philosopher named Mary Midgley, who was kind of like a housewife until 50 or 60 and then decided, I'm going to be a rock star philosopher. So this is one of her books, which is amazing. And what she talks about in this are things that really stood out for me, I wanted to bring up. This idea of philosophy being like plumbing. It's something that we rely on every single day, but we don't think about it until something goes really wrong. And then all of a sudden, you know, we need to call in experts, and it's a big, expensive problem we have to deal with. And so I wanted to kind of gauge the audience to sort of set the stage for talking about the reaction of various animal industries. So hands up if you think, you know, if Happy wins this case, they say Happy has to leave the zoo. Do you, hands up if you think the zoo, the Bronx Zoo, big Bronx Zoo will close, or if other elephants will, you know, be released immediately? Anybody? Oh, okay, we got a few. The fact is that no, this is a common law case, would not impact any other animal. There would still be hundreds of elephants in zoos. This would really just be one animal. And in a kind of similar way, imagine that tomorrow, no pressure, guys, you can get the perfect sell ag steak. Do you think that hands up if cattle ranchers will suddenly quit or giant agribusiness companies will just stop? I think that's kind of obvious, right? We know that that's probably not what's going to happen. And what are some of the reasons why? Well, at least in my experience dealing with the courts, there have been these recurring themes, the doctrine of necessity, social contract, human exceptionalism. And I think these are, you know, a lot of people aren't spending time, you know, science folks maybe not spending a lot of time thinking about these, but when you really get down to it, I think they can be surprisingly durable problems that, you know, can get in the way of all kinds of good stuff that we want to do. So when we talk about the doctrine of necessity, really that's the idea that it means a certain thing in a legal context, but when it's used in this area, it really is, we can't be too nice to animals. We can't extend rights to animals because basically what if we need them again? What if we need to eat them? What if we need to confine them? So it's this utilitarian kind of idea of we want to be nice to them, treat them well, but at the end of the day, we are humans, we're in charge here, and if we need them, we're going to use them. I think a good example of this is for decades, Western countries have been putting a stop to lots of the most invasive kind of brain experiments on primates, but they're making a comeback now, and they're big in China and Japan, and now there's an effort, a push to say, well, we Western countries are falling behind. And people like Elon Musk love being in China for this reason, because they don't have kind of qualms about the kinds of really invasive experiments that they want to do. So you have this pressure of, well, if we relent, if we give animals something, we might lose out a lot ourselves. And then as a kind of more kind of technical legal reason for throwing us out, this is currently the law in New York. The reason, technically speaking, that animals, non-human animals, have no rights and aren't even capable of having rights, according to the courts, is that they aren't capable of taking on legal duties. So in this view, legal rights come from the social contract. Basically, if you're able to take on a duty, you can have rights. And this is a really awful way of deciding who gets rights, but we'll talk a little bit about that, why the reasons are for that. And human exceptionalism, which is kind of self-explanatory, the idea that humans are separate and apart. It's funny because it used to be very explicitly religious, and now when I talk to people, it often comes down to, well, animals, we should be nice to them, but they don't have dignity or some other, you know, fill in the blank with some other elusive, you know, quality. And, you know, for this reason, it justifies treating them completely differently, really categorizing them as things. Because if you're not a person, you're a thing. We have this unfortunate kind of dual system. So if you're not one, you're the other. And so that's where Happy remains, stuck in this situation, in part because of, well, the industry reaction, even though this was a case against a single zoo. As it progressed up the courts, it began to attract the attention of the dairy industry, you know, large national lobby groups, the meat industry, veterinary, you know, you name it. And what they said, which is kind of incredible, but they came into court with their lawyers and said, amicus briefs and different things, if you give a single right to this elephant, it will be the end of the dairy industry in New York, and millions of children will lose out on protein. I kid you not, a dairy industry representative in New York said that in court about this case, which I think on its face is absurd. I mean, you people are going to kill the dairy industry in New York. It's not going to be, probably not going to be happy getting her right. But what this says to me is that there's a whole lot of anxiety if talking about, and you know, granted, this would be a transformative right. To say that an elephant can be a person for any purpose at all, to have any right whatsoever, would really be a transformative thing. However, I don't think it, the same way that if there's, you know, cellular agriculture is available, you know, steaks tomorrow, it's not going to immediately, you know, change this whole massive industry. So for me, it's about how to kind of keep your head when the opposition is, you know, really being inaccurate about, you know, the terms of a debate. So fortunately, not every legal system in the world is so stuck on this issue as we are. So this is a woolly monkey. In Ecuador recently, there was a case that held that under the rights of nature in Ecuador's constitution, which is a really cool and unique thing, wild animals, it's not clear which animals exactly, but at least a fairly wide swath of animals in Ecuador, are now legal persons. They are subjects of rights under the rights of nature. It's kind of being determined what this will mean, but you know, this is just adding to in one more court outside the US that has made a similar decision. And the highest court in Colombia a couple years ago actually ruled that the Amazon rainforest within Colombia is a legal person. So, you know, going back to my previous slide, it's not, you know, these problems aren't, they can seem very intractable and stuck in place and rooted in all this kind of weird philosophy and cognitive dissonance and all kinds of stuff going on, but they can actually, you know, be susceptible to change. And I think the same will be true with meat. And what I think, at least in my experience, you know, you get a lot of people who say, you know, this animals are person stuff. You gotta, you know, I'm with you on the treat them nice, but it's not a person. It's just not a person. And, you know, I would push back on that. You know, corporation is a person. People talk about artificial intelligence as being a person. So, you know, the idea that person can't be extended beyond a human, I think, is absurd. And I think the same is true when we talk about meat. And I think that it might be tempting to sort of pull back from this fight and say, well, you know, we're fake, and I think the opposition will continue. You'll have meat companies and different, you know, interested parties wanting to stop folks like you from marketing these types of products as meat. And, you know, in a similar way, you could say, oh, all right, fine, we'll give up on the person thing. It doesn't have to be meat. We'll call it something else. I think that would screw everybody over. It would screw the animals over, it would screw us over, and I think in a kind of similar way, because these, whether we like it or not, have emerged, at least to me, as these really critical battlegrounds, and we have to keep pushing to really change the definitions of what these words mean. So yeah, we want beer. This was kind of, I think this is a picture from yesterday at about 5 o'clock. But the reason I put this up there is because it's really hard to tell people that they can't have something, right? So I think a lot of well-meaning people from the animal world that I know, they're not great, very enthusiastic about cellular agriculture. And, you know, I think my kind of pushback or whatever response is, I get it, but you're not going to stop people from really kind of clamoring or even getting what they want. You know, there was an amendment, you know, the Constitution, prohibition, you know, didn't stop people from drinking. And so I don't think it's really hard to tell humans that they can't do something. So I think we have to, you know, obviously be mindful of that too. And this guy, you know, I couldn't help but put this up there because, you know, we talk about this idea of dignity. You know, animals can't have rights because they're not dignified. I look at a picture like this and I wonder, you know, who looks more dignified in this picture to you? It's not the guy with the hand, with his hand in the other animal. I find that something got inverted there. And real quickly, you know, this, as obscure, you know, kind of obscure as it may sound, the opposition is really starting to seize on it. So in Idaho, they recently passed a law that says that legal personhood, the capacity for rights, will not be extended beyond a human. It will not be extended to any part of the environment. It will not be extended to an animal. And actually, Happy's case was part of their inspiration for this. So I guess she's a muse in an unfortunate way. But on the other side, there's a bill pending right here in New York that would recognize the Great Lakes and connected ecosystems within the state as legal persons. So there's a rights of nature bill pending right here in New York, which I think is a beautiful thing. And I think, you know, what we want here is a healthy, thriving planet, right? And I think that these philosophical, legal, kind of technical issues, in the same way that we're here talking about these really intense scientific challenges, you know, this, I think, will continue to be part of the process. And, you know, again, if we win for Happy, it's not going to change the situation immediately for individuals like this. But you know, if we really take on and stay mindful of these things, which we have for the last several years, and, you know, not get distracted, because these are, this is well-funded, well-heeled opposition that has a lot of money and feels a real kind of sense of ownership in these industries. And they really hate when, you know, activist lawyers manage to drag them into court. So, however, you know, it opens, I think, this window into some of these issues that, while we might not be thinking about them every day, and, you know, maybe when you're, you know, some folks are working on meat, replacing meat, it's not necessarily coming from a philosophical or kind of animal rights place, but the way I see it, whether or not, whatever your motivation is for doing it, the very process of producing cell ag meat, I think, hits at this doctrine of necessity. It helps to demonstrate in a very real way, no, we actually don't need to use and kill animals in order to live in a, you know, reasonably comfortable way. And we don't need to use a social contract to police, you know, everyone who can have rights. And yeah, we can even get over the idea that we are kind of gods of the planet and that we were put here and, you know, that we're kind of separate and apart from the rest of nature. And it's my hope, and I'll stop there because, again, I lost my script here, but that was the important part of what I wanted to say. And mostly, I think it's, you know, we talked a lot about solving for problems. I think that's super important. But, you know, like I've seen in my work, trying to accomplish a pretty technical, very controversial legal goal, you can't just approach it as a completely technical problem. So I guess my advice from a completely different field would be to kind of apply a little art and science and kind of know when you have to feel your way through a problem more than kind of think your way through a problem. So thank you.
That was awesome.
I'm glad I didn't
I know, you did great. You did great. Also, feeling your way through problems, I really don't think we put enough emphasis on that, right? I think everything has to have a perfectly technical, logical answer. And so much of the work that we do here is driven by gut instinct and feelings and sort of like constitution, personal constitution. So one of the first questions that I have for you is about sort of the distinction between what a lot of folks in this room, I imagine, probably share a perspective on around what is moral versus what is legal. Mm-hmm. And what are often I find, particularly here in the US, what's legal lags behind often what people consider to be, a lot of people consider to be moral. So how do you actually bring those two closer together? Is it through things like this? Do we need more people who will represent elephants in the room, or?
You know, I think that's a big part of it, because I think, so I got into this work for, agriculture was a big driver. I was like, wow, this food system's messed up. How do we even come close to using the law and policy to try to nibble away at this problem? And what I learned pretty quickly was that, wow, it's really hard to do anything for a farmed animal. I mean, they practically don't exist when it comes to the law, especially if you're talking about a chicken. Then you got this whole thing about accepted farming practices. So, you know, the welfare laws might not even apply to most animals, especially the ones that are kind of in the worst situations in factory farms and things. But I found that you almost have to be, well, see, it's funny, because our case really is just about an elephant. And like I said, it's not going to kill the dairy industry. It's not going to open all the zoos. But I think when you get that kind of reaction, you have to know how to work with it a little bit and sort of show it to other people so that they can kind of see, like, well, wait a minute. This just seems like a pretty extreme reaction for just trying to, you know, put one elephant in a nicer place. So there is an element of, like, I don't know, kind of a show to it in a way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And a story, the story gets told around it is really important. I don't know, I bet that Atlantic article about this sparked a lot of new thoughts in people's minds about their conception of an elephant and what it means to be in captivity. How would you define the threshold for rights for an organism? And I think this is a legal question, not a moral question, but is it sentience? Is it cognition? Like where the line is fuzzy. Where does it get drawn?
It's funny because it does strike you as a legal question, and maybe it should be a legal question,
yeah.
But when you really get down to it and try to get a judge or a court to really tell you an answer, that's when you start to find out, oh, crap, this is all philosophically loaded, and that's kind of, you know, where my inspiration for the talk came from. So I guess the simplest way is there really is no defined threshold. Right now, it's are you a human, are you not a human? And I mentioned this whole idea of the ability to take on duties, that being the line right now. But the fact is, many humans can't take on legal duties, whether permanently or temporarily, if you're a child, or if you're suffering, say, Alzheimer's or dementia, if you're in a coma. But you don't lose your rights. And so, you know, the line right now is just in this very strange place. If you happen to kind of find yourself in a human shell, then you can have some rights. If you don't, well, then you can't. But what we've been arguing about, I didn't get to touch on it as much, is autonomy, right? If science can show that a being is autonomous, and by that I don't mean like a self-driving car, like a marketing gimmick or something. I mean, literally, you have a sense of yourself. You have the capacity to appreciate your past, your present, plan for your future. In a lot of ways, philosophically speaking, that's kind of been the classic, one classic way to be a person, right? You are a subject. You're an entity. You have thoughts. You have goals. You have dreams. You have social organization. But there's nowhere out there in the law that says, oh, yeah, if you check off this box, if you're autonomous, you necessarily get a right. So what we've done, you know, with a case like ours with an elephant who is clearly meets these characteristics, we say, judge, you have to at the least recognize that this very highly cognitively advanced individual can have at least one right. And sometimes that gets confused. People say, well, is that the line? You have to be super smart. No, just not. And I think for us, it's really about getting any court to say that any animal can have any right whatsoever. And then I think my personal take, and this is already starting to happen, is that the issue gets taken up in a more legislative way, and they start thinking about, well, what are the actual ways that you can have rights, sentience, cognition? So I think over time, my hope is that it will expand, but I also don't think you can go into court right now and say sentience, because sentience is really broad. And even if you want that to happen as a moral thing, you know, if you're a lawyer, you have to think, well, or a scientist or whoever you are, you have to kind of balance, like, what do I want to happen? What do I wish could happen? And what is actually even remotely technically feasible? And so for us, we get pushback from that sometimes, saying you guys are, you know, kind of putting these animals on a pedestal. You're making it impossible for a chicken to ever get rights. My response to that is more, well, we want chickens to have rights. We got to work on cellular agriculture. That's kind of my...
I love that sound bite. I hope somebody was recording that. If we want chickens to have rights, we got to work on cellular agriculture. But that also leads us into the next question very nicely, actually, which is, what do you think of the animal rights critique that cell ag reinforces meat culture? And this person, whoever asked this, defines that as the centrality and necessity of animal flesh on our plates.
Yeah, so I think it's, I struggle with this a lot. I've been talking to some people here about it because I come from, you know, animal rights background and really kind of drawing a very firm and hard line. But I've really changed on that myself. Like, for example, I don't think taking a biopsy of a cow and using that to create cellular meat, personally, I don't have an issue with that. But yeah, at the same time, it is, you know, I take this kind of question seriously, but I also just kind of like going back to the prohibition thing, like, if a government tried to outlaw meat right now anywhere, my God, like, you would see turmoil and uprisings like you probably can't imagine. So I think you have to, you kind of, it's sort of like what it is with a judge. Judges are humans too, and humans at large, you kind of have to take them as they are with all the problems that entails. And yeah, it's not perfect. It's kind of matrixy, but I don't know of a better way right now. Unless you can make some, I don't know, make meat that looks like, I don't know, not meat, or I don't know.
I know, we're going to come full circle. We're going to start making meat that looks like plants. It's going to be a whole thing.
Yeah.
And then we're really going to have made it. I think we have time for one more question. And I think you already sort of addressed the third one down here.
So how do we know happy is unhappy? Well,
how do we know if happy?
Yeah,
is
you don't take a lawyer's word. You know, we get testimony, evidence, you know, written submissions. public comments from some of the leading elephant researchers in the world, people like Joyce Poole. And so when we say that happy's not happy, we're not saying, oh, this is just our take as just lawyers, our hot take. No, these are people who are trained in this, who studied captive elephants, studied wild elephants, and they know that when an elephant like Happy is just standing there kind of swaying, you know, sometimes the zoos will say, oh, she's dancing, she's fine. No, that's actually a sign of like horrific suffering, like the same way that you or I, you stuck us in a box for 40 years. Eventually, we're probably just going to sit there and kind of like sway. So it's not us. And this has been one of the zoo's kind of main, believe it or not, they go to court and they say happy is happy. I mean, you can't kind of make this stuff up, but that's their main argument. And also, oh, judge, if you do this, human society as we know it will collapse. So that's how I think we know we're on to something.
Okay, yeah. Well, thank you so much, Kevin. Yeah. This was amazing.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You just, nice. And I think you can just, oh. Yeah. Okay. Folks, this was a very, very interesting morning for all of us. Couple of things. So first, I just want to reset. Because I rushed up here, and we did a quick thing, and then we started the day, and we didn't have a chance to settle in. And that's partially because I was a little late and uncaffeinated. So just want to start over and say welcome to everyone again. There were some folks that weren't in the room earlier. I think we have a critical mass now. So welcome to New Harvest 2022. And I just want to reinforce that these are the kinds of discussions that can only happen at New Harvest. These are the kinds of discussions that we want to continue to have. And so, you know, make sure to support New Harvest, right? We have a goal. Isha came up on stage yesterday and said that we're trying to get $18 million for the next 4 years, but I personally have been donating to New Harvest to the tune of only $25 a month, but for about 7 years. They also take small grassroots donations, so if you don't feel like, if $18 million feels like too big of a number, five, 25, all of it helps. I'm personally gonna be increasing my donation to $100 a month. I'll see what else I can work into my budget, but I hope that will inspire a lot of other people to sort of, right, the community can actually build up and help New Harvest. And so a couple of other things. Claire, who was up here on stage announcing the Venture Studio for Cellular Agriculture that is starting at New Lab, asked me to emphasize for you that you don't actually have to have your own idea to come to them and say, hey, this is what I want to build. They also have theses and hypotheses that they've been working to create with this community. And if you just come to them and you say, hey, I want to build, they will work with you to find what you are excited about, and they will point you at that thing. So don't even feel like you have to come up with the idea yet. If you have an idea, great. But you don't need to have an idea to get started. So that's one thing.
Come to me.
Amazing. Thank you so much. What's your name? Sorry.
Maisha.
Go talk to Maisha. Okay. And what is the other thing? Oh, right. I didn't even introduce myself this morning. Hi, I'm Kristen Ellis. I'm a partner at Lower Carbon Capital. That is what I do for my full-time job. We're, like many of you, are on a mission to unfuck the planet. Very excited about that. Last thing before I let you go for coffee break. We are going to do the New Harvest group photo. So if you haven't been to New Harvest before, what we do is we all get in a big sort of cuddle puddle out in the hall, and we take a group photo that demonstrates sort of our excitement about being here at New Harvest and to demonstrate the size and how the community has grown. So before you run upstairs, before you do anything, Mira, I want to make sure I have this right. We're going to go right outside in the hall. The photographer is going to be up on the bridge right here. So you're going to go out in the hall, cluster together, look up in that direction. We're going to take a big, exciting group photo together. You're going to get some coffee, and then we're going to come back here at, I believe, what time is it? 11:30 sharp. Okay, so let's go take this picture. Thanks, everybody. Yes. Oh, heck yes. Vireo Advisors is donating $2,500, I think.
We'll do this in the town hall.
Yes. Amazing.